Welcome everyone. In the previous videos, we have studied how to apply Gauss law on a point charge, and also we have studied for the case of a spherical shell. Now we are going to apply Gauss law for planar surfaces. We are going to start with a planar surface of a conductive material with uniform distributed surface charge density. And as we mentioned before, if we have a charged conducting structure, the electric charges will be distributed on the outer surface of the conductor, and there is no any excess of a charge inside the conductor itself. Also, we mentioned that inside the conductor, the electric field is zero. So, if we are talking about the electric field E and just outside the conductor surface, must also be perpendicular to the surface, should be perpendicular to the surface. And if it were not, if the electric field is not perpendicular to the surface, this means that I have some tangential field component. In the case if I have tangential field component, this tangential field component will introduce motion of the electric charges on the surface. And this motion will occur only at non-equilibrium state. But if I'm saying that I have reached the equilibrium state such that the charges are distributed uniformly along the surface of the conductor, then all the charges are constant in their places. This means that there is no tangential electric field along the surface. Or in other words, the electric fields from the conductor surface is always normal to the surface of the conductor. That's what we are seeing. If the electric field were not perpendicular, then it would have a component along the conductor surface or tangential to the conductor surface that would exert forces on the surface charge, causing them to move, which violates the assumption that we are dealing with the electrostatic equilibrium. So, in equilibrium state, the electric field going outside the conductor surface is always normal to the surface. Okay? Now, assuming that the charge distribution, the surface charge distribution along the surface is sigma, where sigma is in coulomb per meter squared, and it is required to find out the electric field going outside this conducting surface. To obtain the electric field going outside this conducting surface, in this case, we are going to draw a Gaussian surface consisting of a cylindrical shape like this. This Gaussian surface has three faces. Face number one, face number two, and face number three. The normal to face number 1 is the direction A1, which is also perpendicular to the surface of the conductor. This means that the normal of face 1, it would be in parallel to the proposed direction of the electric field, which is normal to the surface. For the case of face 2, phase 2 lies inside the conductor material itself. And as we said, inside the conductor material, the electric field is zero. Finally, phase 3 has a normal direction, which is parallel to the surface. And we said that the electric field, due to an infinite surface, it should be perpendicular to the surface. This means that the tangential or the normal component to the phase 3, it would have an angle 90 degrees with respect to the direction of the electric field. This means that the value of E dot the area where the area is located on surface 3, it would be 0, because cosine while over 2 it will be 0. So if you are interested to find out the total flux passing through this closed surface, in this case it will be the integration over the closed surface E dot dA, which is divided to be E dot A1 plus E dot A2 plus E dot A3. E dot A1, it would be the magnitude of the electric field multiplied by the magnitude of the surface area, A. E dot A2, it would be 0, because E here is 0. E dot A3, it would be 0, because the normal direction to A3 is perpendicular to the direction of the electric field. So the dot product would be 0, because the angle between the normal here and the angle between the electric field is 90 degrees. Okay? This means that the total flux passing through this closed surface would be simply E multiplied by A, where E is the electric field normal to the conducting surface and A is the cross section area of this surface, this circular surface. Alright? According to Gauss law, we say that epsilon naught multiplied by the flux, the total flux passing through a closed surface, equals the charge enclosed inside this closed surface, equals Q enclosed. In the present case, the charge is also allocated at the surface of the conductor. So, the total charge enclosed by this cylinder, it would be the charge density sigma multiplied by this cross area, which is actually the same area here. So, assuming that we are going to call this capital A, so this also it would be capital A. So, the total charge inside this closed surface is the charge density, the surface charge density sigma multiplied by this surface area A. So according to Gauss law, epsilon naught phi would equal the enclosed charge Q enclosed, and Q enclosed in the present case is sigma multiplied by A. So epsilon naught E multiplied by A, which is epsilon naught multiplied by phi, equals Q enclosed, which is sigma multiplied by A. Now, by eliminating A with A, we can say that the magnitude of the electric field in this case, E, would be simply the surface charge density sigma over epsilon naught. So, it can be noted here that the electric field going outside a planar conducting surface with uniform charge distribution, with charge distribution or charge density sigma, is a constant value, and this constant value is always normal to the surface of the conductor, and the magnitude of the electric field is sigma over epsilon naught. If the charge is positive charge, the electric field would be going outside the conductor surface. If the electric charge density is negative, if this is negative charge, so the electric field lines will enter inside the conducting surface. Thus, the magnitude of the electric field just outside the conductor is proportional to the surface charge density on the conductor. It means that it is not inversely proportional to any distance. It is not inversely proportional to R or R squared as in the case of point charge. Means it is a constant value. The sign of the charge gives us the direction of the electric field. If the sign is positive, so the electric field is going outside the conductor surface. If the sign is negative, the electric field is going inside the conductor surface. If the charge on the conductor is positive, the electric field is direct away from the conductor. If the charge on the conductor is negative, the electric field is direct toward the conductor. And in general, the magnitude of the electric field on a conductor surface with a uniform charge distribution sigma equals sigma over epsilon naught. The question now, what will be the situation if I am talking about insulating sheet? The main difference between the insulating sheet and conductor sheet is that the insulating sheet allows the electric field for the charge distribution to be in forward and backward directions. In the case of conductor material, the electric field inside the conductor is zero. Alright? So, if I have an non-uniform insulating sheet with a uniform charge distribution sigma, and it is required to find out the magnitude of the electric field due to this charge distribution, at the beginning, we are going to assume that the electric field, it would be forward and backward. It is not only forward, or it is not only backward, alright? And by applying Gauss law in the same way which we have done for a conductor sheet, we are going to present a Gaussian surface in the form of a closed cylinder like this. And in this case, we have three surface areas, area 1, area 2, and area 3. For area 1, the perpendicular or the normal to the direction of the area is going in this direction, which is the same as the direction of the electric field, assuming that we have positive charge. And in area 2, the normal would be in the opposite direction, and also the electric field will be in the opposite direction, because the positive charge emits the electric field lines to be going away from the positive charge. So if I'm looking from this direction, it's going in this direction. If I'm looking in this direction, it will be going in this direction. So here in positive x, here in negative x. Alright? At the same time, the normal to the area A, here in positive x, here in negative x. So in both cases, if I'm talking about E dot A, both cases, the electric field will be in the same direction of the normal to the area. So it is simply the magnitude of E multiplied by A. And also, in the other case, E and A are in the same direction. So, the dot multiplication, E dot A, will be simply the magnitude of A multiplied by the magnitude, magnitude of E multiplied by magnitude of A. For the third surface, the normal surface, it would be tangential to the surface, or in other words, it would be normal to the direction of the electric field. So, the dot product between the normal to the third surface and the direction of the electric field, it would be zero, because cosine, the angle between them, is cosine pi over 2, which is zero. Okay? Now, applying Gauss law states that epsilon naught multiplied by the total flux through a closed surface equals the charge enclosed by the surface, this enclosed surface. Okay? In the present case, the integration over the closed surface, it would be E multiplied by A for phase 1 plus E multiplied by A for phase 2 plus 0 for phase 3. So E plus A, E multiplied by A plus E multiplied by A. This is the total flux multiplied by epsilon naught. It would be equal to the enclosed charge. The enclosed charge in the present case assumes that we are talking about this cylinder. The enclosed charge inside this cylinder is effectively the charge distribution on this surface multiplied by the surface area. The charge distribution is sigma, and this surface area is equal to the same value of A. So, the charge enclosed inside this closed surface is simply sigma A. From this, we can eliminate the value of A. So the value of E, the magnitude of the electric field in this case, it would be simply sigma over 2 epsilon. Sigma over 2 epsilon. It is interesting to note that the magnitude of the electric field in this case is half the magnitude of the electric field for a conducting sheet. For a conducting sheet, it was sigma over epsilon naught. Why? Because in the case of the conducting sheet, all the electric field lines due to the surface charge distributions is going in one way. So they are accumulated only in positive x. Here, in the case of non-conducting sheet, the electric field lines are distributed between positive x and negative x. So the density of the electric charge lines in this case, it would be half the value of the density of the electric charge density for the conducting sheet. And in the case of the conducting sheet, it was sigma over epsilon naught. So half of this value is sigma over 2 epsilon naught. Okay. Another interesting point. If you remember, we have calculated this equation before. If you remember, we calculated by using the surface charge distribution on a circular disk. When we said that the circular disk can be represented as small rings, small concentric rings, and we calculate the field due to each ring, and by calculating the field due each ring, we integrated the fields due to the different rings together to take the electric field for a circular disk. And we said that if the radius of the circular disk tends to infinity, which is the case of infinite insulating sheet like this, we proved that the electric field is sigma over 2 epsilon naught. By using directly Coulomb's law to calculate the electric field in this case, we are going to use complicated integrations to obtain this result. This shows us the advantage of using Gauss' law in determining the electric field due to complicated structures. Alright? Okay. The question now, what will be the situation if I am talking about a conducting blade? In the previous example, I mentioned a conducting surface. Now I have a conducting blade with two surfaces. If I have a conducting blade with two surfaces and I said that this conducting blade has a uniform charge distribution, this means that this charge distribution is allocated in both sides of the conducting medium. Because, as we mentioned before, if I have a separated conducting blade or separated conducting structure, the current distribution will be separated on the outer surface. So now I have two outer surfaces for the conducting blade. So if I am talking about a conducting blade charged with surface charge density sigma 1, this means that I have sigma 1 on side on the right side, and also I have sigma 1 on the left side. On the other hand, I don't have any charge or any electric field inside the blade or the conducting blade itself. For this case, if I'm going to study the electric field due to this sigma 1, it would be the electric field here, sigma 1 over epsilon, which is the electric field due to a conducting sheet, which we have already proved. On the other hand, if I'm looking for the electric field on the other side, it would be also sigma 1 over epsilon in a negative direction. And in between, there is no electric field at all. So, if I'm going to draw the electric field in this case, as a function of x, it would be positive sigma 1 over epsilon in positive x, negative sigma 1 over epsilon in negative x. Negative field means in negative x direction, zero in between. On the other hand, if the conducting sheet is charged with negative charge distribution, so assuming that the value of sigma is negative, then the electric field lines, instead of going outside the sheet, would be going inside the sheet. And the magnitude of the electric field is still sigma 1 over epsilon. The question now, what will be the situation if I have two sheets close to each other, one with a charge distribution sigma 1 And the other with the charge distribution sigma 1, positive and negative. For this case, assume that we have two infinite conducting sheets or two conducting plates, and each one is charged with charge density sigma 1, one is positive and the other is negative. Then the electric field, the negative charges on the negative plate, which is allocated on the outer side, and the positive charges on the positive plate, which are allocated on the outer side, will be attracted to each other, such that all the charges will be accumulated only inside in the inner side. What actually happened? I have negative charge here and negative charge here. Alright? And this is conducting material. So the charges are free to move. Effectively, the negative charge here will exert repelling force on the negative charge here. So both of them are going to the most outer side of the plate. In a similar way, the positive charge here and positive charge here repelling each other, such that they are going to the outer sides of the two plates. Each charge will take one side from the plate. When I have nearby negative plate to positive plate, the negative plate or the negative charge in the outer side has been attracted to the positive charge in the outer side of the other plate, such that this negative charge has moved inside the conductor plate, because the conductor plate allows the charge to move. The negative charge had moved to the inner side to be as near as possible from the positive charge here. And the positive charge here has moved along the conductor plate or the conductor medium to the inner side to be as close as possible to the negative charge. So in this case, all the positive charges are accumulated in the inner side, and all the negative charges are accumulated in the inner side for the other plate. So effectively, for the original distribution, this was sigma 1. If I bring the other charge to the other side, it means that I have doubled the charge density on the inner side and make the charge density on the outer side to be 0. So the total charge density in this case is positive 2 sigma 1, and the total charge density in this case is negative 2 sigma 1, while the charge density on the outer surfaces are 0. Now, by applying Gauss law, if I have a closed surface here, to obtain the magnitude of the electric field, I'll see that the electric field, it would equal the charge density, which is 2 sigma 1 multiplied by the area, over epsilon naught multiplied by the area. So it would be 2 sigma 1 over epsilon. It has been doubled. Doubled the why? Because the charge density has been doubled. This means that the electric field inside or between the two plates will be the double value of the electric field of a separate sheet. For the separate sheet, the electric field was simply sigma 1 over epsilon naught. Now, the electric field has been doubled, 2 sigma 1 over epsilon naught. Okay? On the other hand, if I have looking at outer point here, so if I have enclosed surface like this, the enclosed surface in this case will have no charges inside it. So the electric field outside the plate from the left or from the right, it would be 0. So if I have positive and negative conducting plates, if I have positive and needed conducting blades, and both of them have the same charge density, this positive and this is negative, the total electric field will be located only between the two blades, while outside the blades, the electric field it would be zero from the right and the left. Effectively, this situation is quite famous situation for the barrel blade capacitor. And when we are going to study the capacitor, we are going to use this configuration in many problems. That's what we are seeing for applying Gauss law in planar form, oppositely charged to barrel conducting blades. The field is directed away from positive charge blade and towards the negative charge blade. There is no excess charge in the left outer side. There is no excess charge on the right outer side. So since there is no excess charge in the left on the outer faces, the electric field to the left and the right blades would be zero. Alright? Okay. This for the case of two conducting blades. And we should know in conducting blades, the electric charges are free to move and we don't have any charge inside the conducting blade. What will be the situation if we are talking about non-conducting blade? If you have positive and negative non-conducting blade. In this case, the situation will be completely different because the electric field can pass the dielectric material or insulating material. But the electric field here cannot pass inside the conducting material. So, in the case of two non-conducting blades, assuming that I have a non-conducting blade with surface charge sigma plus and another non-conducting blade with the surface charge sigma minus, and it is required to find the electric field in the left side between the two blades and in the right side. How we can calculate it? It should be noted here, in the case of non-conducting blade, the electric field of the positive charge will pass to the other side of the negative blade. And the electric field due to the negative charge will pass to the other side of the positive blade. So, it will not be shielded by the dielectric shield. For the conducting blade, it will be shielded by the conducting blade because the conducting blade does not support or does not allow the electric field to pass through the conducting medium. Right? So, if we have two large barrel non-conducting sheets, each with fixed uniform charge on one side, and assuming that the magnitude of the surface charge densities are sigma plus is 6.8 microcoulomb per meter square for positive charge sheet, and sigma minus is 4.3 microcoulomb per meter square for negatively charged sheet. Find the electric field to the left of the sheets here, between the two sheets, and to the right of the sheet. As I mentioned, if I'm going to calculate the field due to the negative charge sheet, I'll assume that I don't have any positive charge sheet because this electric field can pass the non-conducting blade. In a similar way, if I'm looking for the electric field due to the positive charge sheet, it will be calculated as if I don't have any negative sheet or any other sheet because the electric field can pass the non-conducting sheet. So I'm going to calculate the electric field due to the positive sheet separately and the electric field due to the negative sheet separately, and then at each region I'm going to add the electric field in vector summation. This is our plan to do this. So assuming that I'm looking for the positive charge blade, for the positive charge blade the electric field E plus, it would be sigma plus over 2 epsilon, and it will be distributed in positive x in the right side and in negative x in the left side. So the magnitude of the electric field due to the positive charge sheet, it would be sigma plus, which is 6.8 microcoulomb, micro is 10 to the power minus 6, over 2 epsilon, 2 multiplied by 8.85 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 11 coulomb squared in Newton column square per Newton meter square. By calculating this, we find that the magnitude of the electric field E plus is 3.84 multiplied by 10 to the power 5 Newton per coulomb. And as I said, if I'm looking in positive x direction, it would be in positive, if I'm looking in the right direction, it would be in positive x direction. If I'm looking in left direction, it would be in negative x direction. So this is the magnitude of E plus here, this is the magnitude of E plus here, and this is the magnitude and direction of E plus here. In a similar way, the electric field due to the negative charge sheet, it would be sigma minus over 2 epsilon. And its direction, if I'm looking at the right side, it would be in negative x direction. If I'm looking in left side or in between, it would be in positive x direction and in positive x direction. So the direction of the electric field due to the negative sheet in the right, it would be negative x, in between it would be in positive x, in left it would be in positive x. As a magnitude, the magnitude of the electric field due to the minus charge distribution is sigma minus over 2 epsilon. Sigma minus is 4.3 microcoulomb, 4.3 multiplied by 10 to the power minus 6 coulomb per meter squared over 2 epsilon naught. We calculate this, we find that the electric field, the magnitude of the electric field minus is 2.43 multiplied by 10 to the power 5 Newton per coulomb. Now, we have total electric field in the left side. We have total electric field between the two plates. We have total electric field in the right side. The total electric field in the left side, it would be E plus minus E minus, because this in this direction, this in the other direction, E plus minus E minus, and as a magnitude, E plus is greater than E minus, so the magnitude or the direction, it would be in negative x direction. Between the two plates, it would be E plus plus E minus. E plus E minus, because they are in the same direction, and their direction would be in positive x direction. In the right, it would be E plus minus E minus, because E plus is greater than E minus, and its direction could be in the direction of E plus, which is positive x direction. So E left is E plus minus E minus, and according to what we have calculated for E plus and E minus, E plus minus E minus, so the magnitude of E left is 1.4 multiplied by 10 to the power 5 Newton per coulomb. In between, it would be E plus plus E minus, E plus E minus, the magnitude of E plus the magnitude of E minus. By taking the summation of this, it would be 6.3 multiplied by 10 to the power 5 Newton per coulomb. And its direction could be in positive x direction. Finally, E right, it would be E plus minus E minus, which is the same like this. And its direction in this case, it would be in positive x direction. So we have two separate cases. We have the case of two conducting plates, and we have the case of dielectric or insulating plates. For conducting plates, the electric field cannot pass through the conducting plate, but for the case of dielectric plates or insulating plates, the electric fields can pass through the dielectric plate. Okay. All right.